Good afternoon. I'm Warren Hoag, IPI's Senior Advisor for External Relations, and I'm happy to welcome you to this discussion with Jean-Marie Guéhenno, the President and CEO of the International Crisis Group and former UN Undersecretary General for Peacekeeping Operations. Our conversation today has as its centerpiece his just published memoir, The Fog of Peace. And Jean-Marie will reflect on some of the most difficult questions facing international interventions today and the future of UN peacekeeping in a world of renewed geopolitical competition. Peacekeeping, by the way, is in the DNA of the International Peace Institute. We began our existence in 1970 as the International Peace Academy, or IPA, and our purpose was to train UN peacekeepers, something the UN itself could not do at that time owing to Cold War tensions. Our first president was an Indian general and former peacekeeper named Indit Jik Rikki. And right in this building, he was schooling uniformed soldiers in the skills of peacekeeping. We ceased doing that decades ago, and in 2008, swapped the name Academy for Institute, but peacekeeping remains a core interest of IPI. Jean-Marie Guéhenno became the head of the Department of Peacekeeping Operations in 2000. At a time when UN peacekeeping had been downsizing for a couple of years, the common wisdom had become, as he puts it in the book, that UN peacekeeping was, quote, a thing of the past, unquote. That prediction turned out to be spectacularly wrong, because over the next 8 years, he was to oversee the largest expansion of peacekeeping missions in UN history. And those years were very consequential ones, with peacekeeping being tasked with broad new responsibilities and becoming more complex, more dangerous, and in some notorious cases, highlighted by the UN Press Corps, of which I was then a member, more controversial. The book is a personal memoir, and Jean-Marie writes that as a young man, he imagined life as an intellectual, not as what he calls the operational official he was to become. That, however, is one of the strengths of this book. In office, he did become an upfront globe-trotting practitioner, but behind the scenes, he remained a thinker, filling, by his count, 18 notebooks with his thoughts. This very thoughtful book is the result. It is also very candid. He writes openly about the difficulties of conducting peacekeeping when the Secretariat tries to, quote, micromanage, unquote, from afar, when the great powers have less ability to shape events, and when member states find it convenient to blame the UN for their own collective failures. Besides the fact that peacekeeping is often thought of as the flagship of the United Nations, but warns also that it is also the UN's riskiest activity. His critique of the UN itself is constructive but unsparing. I particularly liked his description of reports produced by the bureaucracy of the UN as, quote, reports in which everything said is factually correct, and yet where nothing really stimulates fresh thinking. That happily in no way describes this stimulating book. And in that connection, let me remind you that copies are for sale at the door, and I will make sure we finish early enough to allow time for Jean-Marie to sign purchase copies and chat with you. I have found in talking about the book in this community that one of my principal takeaways is a point that seems to be coming up in the various high-level reviews currently underway as the UN commemorates its 70 years of existence. That point is that UN peacekeeping is, quote, essentially a political undertaking, and that this political dimension is something not fully understood and given the prominence it deserves. Jean-Marie's purpose in composing the memoir may be best explained by this phrase, which incorporates the book's title. Peacekeeping, he writes, far from being a cynical enterprise aimed at preserving peace at any price, can be successful only if it is understood as a highly moral enterprise. One needs a reliable compass to navigate through the fog of peace. Here's the compass. Here's the author. Please welcome Jean-Marie Guéhenno.
Well, thank you very much, Warren, for arranging this event. I'm very happy to be here. I recognize a number of friends, and I'm going to speak, I hope not too long, just to reflect on a few issues that I address in my little book. And maybe first I should explain why I wrote it as a memoir. There are many books on peacekeeping, many analytical books, but I felt that it was important to have, in a way, the confusion of action to understand peacekeeping. Because as you address situations, difficult crises around the world, you are in a situation where you don't know, of course, what the views of the various, what is the intent, what are going to be the actions of the various actors. You yourself have at the time your own sense of where you want to go, but actually in hindsight maybe you will rethink what you thought you were thinking. That's why I as you said, I wrote these little notebooks, because I felt that if I was going to write on memory, I would reorganize events to suit me, not by out of dishonesty, but because memory is a rational instrument that transforms things. And it was important in a book to convey, yes, the fog of action, the confusion, the uncertainties, because that is at the heart of peacekeeping. It's all about trade-offs. It's about taking some risks, measuring them. But you only know in hindsight whether you have been right or wrong. And in the book, I delve, for instance, in one of the chapters on the intervention of a multinational force, a French-led multinational force in Ituri, in northeastern Congo. And it's a typical example of the kind of difficult choices that you have to make. Here you have tens of thousands of people who might die. You don't have, because of the way the resolution is worded, you don't have an obligation to do anything about it because you are not deployed in the area. So the first thing is, do you deploy in the area at the risk then of creating an obligation for you? But the risk is deeper than that, because as you deploy, you create enormous expectations. I went to that little town in northeastern Congo called Bunia, the capital of the Ituri district. And as we were deploying troops there, you could see there was very small number of troops, but you could see thousands of people hugging the runway, hugging the little compound that had been created there. And you could very well see how you could, if things went badly wrong, you could create another Srebrenica, because those people suddenly had high expectations with the UN, and there was no real capacity to seriously protect them. So we decided to do that, and eventually it worked out, because then a force was deployed and the dynamics of the situation in Ituri were changed. But you know only in hindsight that you were right, because maybe it could have gone terribly wrong, and then this thing would be remembered as a shameful moment of the UN where a promise was made and not kept. That is the choice that you have to make, and that's why I thought writing the book as a memoir was a good thing, to convey precisely those uncertainties where you will only know in hindsight whether you were right or wrong. This book obviously is about the United Nations, and there what I just addressed, the question of risk, is key. When I look at the way the UN works, the UN, sadly, is a very risk-averse organization. It's much better not to take risk for a career at the UN. But it's much better for the UN to take risks. But all the incentives are geared against risk taking. And that is something that needs to change, because risk taking, let's be honest, is bureaucratic risk. I'm not talking about getting shot. Yeah, I'm talking about getting a promotion or not getting a promotion. So that's that should be a manageable risk. But at the heart of the UN commitment, there has to be that willingness to take some risk, some calculated risk. And of course, there again, there are trade-offs, because as you take risks, if you succeed, there will be all the member states will claim victory for you. If you fail, indeed, you will be a very lonely person, considered reckless and not having thought through the implications. So there again, you have to make your choices. But I do believe actually that it is very important for leaders in the UN to encourage risk-taking up to a point, intelligent risk-taking. And often it's not the case, because if the staff feel that if they do something wrong, then they will be hanged, it's not good. They have to be encouraged to take that risk. But the UN is much more than risk-taking. It's about the international civil servant. And when I became the head of the PKO, I was under no illusion that one of the reasons why I was, one of the key reasons why I was the head of the PKO was my passport. I happened to have a French passport. And so I used to tell my staff that in a way it was a lesson of humility, because I had now to prove that if I was in that position, it was not just because of my passport, that I would justify what I was, that had been selected, also because maybe I could add something to the work of the United Nations. But behind that question, that the Secretary General, as he appoints senior officials, has to balance the various powers that have influence in the great influence in the Security Council. At the same time, he has to be his own man or his own woman tomorrow, maybe, hopefully. that requires a delicate balance. And in my own case, as I thought about it, I thought, okay, I've been appointed. Well, Kofi Annan chose me among various candidates, but certainly he had decided he would have a French person for that position. So what does that mean? The Charter very clearly states that you are not to take instructions from any member states, and I don't think I ever took any instruction from France. I felt at the same time that probably in a position like that one, it would be useful to explain France to the Secretary General, and France is a complicated country, and to explain the United Nations to France. And the United Nations is a complicated organization. And in that sense, being French could be useful.
Jean-Marie, I just want to interrupt you to say we deliberately planned this event for Bastille Day.
Thank you. So you see, there is some relevance there. So I thought I had to walk that very delicate balance where I'd be an independent person, completely independent. And when there was an issue where I felt that France had a very strong interest, let's say like Côte d'Ivoire, at the time I was head of peacekeeping, I would try to be, as little engaged as possible. I had the chance of having a remarkable deputy in the person of Hedi Annaby, who died in the Haiti earthquake. and he was leading on that file, because I didn't want to be squeezed between my loyalty to the United Nations and antagonizing French to the point where it would complicate actually the life of the United Nations. But it is a delicate balance to engineer. And being an international civil servant is a difficult thing, because you can be very self-righteous about it. You can say you speak for the Charter, you speak for the people of the world, and so all those member states, they are just an inconvenience. The United Nations would do so much better without its member states. That's not quite realistic. And that's actually wrong, because the United Nations is that delicate balance, the Charter, between we the people, but it's an organization of states. And you have to manage that tension, that states do not work in the best interest of their people, but they are there. And if you ignore them, you ignore them at your own peril. And that's one of the ways in which you have very tricky moral dilemmas again, because as you look at that, you see that if you fundamentally antagonize one of the powerful member states, the United Nations is not going to be able to work. If you are the puppet of that member state, you betray everything that the United Nations stands for. And so you need to pick your fight, so to speak. My own experience is actually that the Secretariat has much more leeway than it thinks it has. That in reality, except on those issues, and these are of course big exceptions, where one major power has a strong interest, let's say, United States as it in Iraq, when it was deployed massively in Iraq. There, the space left for the UN is very small, and there is a risk that the UN just becomes a cover there, and that was that's in my view what was so tragic in the death of our colleagues in Baghdad on the 19th of August 2003, when they were not in a position to really make a difference. They were just there as Kieran Prendergast, the Undersecretary at the time for political affairs, said, to add tone. And you don't die just to add tone. So you have to, but these are exceptional situations. There are many situations where in reality most member states, including the powerful ones, if you come up with a reasonably intelligent, sound idea, you can actually push it much more than people think. And so I think that the United Nations, although it's a very, it's the intergovernmental organization par excellence, has actually more leeway than many in the Secretariat believe. Now, another point I want to make is my book is about, of course, the use of force. When people wanted to flatter me, they say, oh, you are the Minister of Defense of the United Nations as head of peacekeeping. And I had to disabuse them, because in reality, peacekeeping is much more than being the Minister of Defense, and much less because obviously the kind of force that the UN musters does not have the capacity to wage war, and so one should be very realistic about what it can achieve. But at the same time, it's much more than a Ministry of Defense, because it's about the use of force as a leverage to achieve a political goal and to calibrate force in search of a political strategy. And that is often overlooked by the Security Council, which looks at force in a very crude way sometimes. And even the concept of protection of civilians, which is at the same time the obvious thing to do and needs more thought, the obvious thing to do, because if you see civilians in danger and you have the capacity to protect them, obviously you should do it, and there should be no need for a Security Council resolution to authorize that. But at the same time, it is much more complicated because no UN force has a capacity to really provide broad protection to civilians. So in reality, the force is there to help build a state that will have the trust of its people, who will, and that state will then protect the people. So it's all about the politics beyond the use of force. And throughout the book, I look at various situations in which peacekeepers were deployed, in which the expectation of use of force was somewhat there, whether it's the Democratic Republic of the Congo or Darfur, for instance. And I am struck by the fact that force could never achieve by itself any political result. It can be one element in a much broader strategy. And if it is anything more than that, then it's bound to disappoint. And I think the discussion on robust peacekeeping, and myself, I pushed for robust peacekeeping, leads often to mistaken conclusions, because it leads to the notion that force can be a substitute for an intelligent political strategy. And it's all in the calibration, in reality, of when you pick your fights, there again, what circumstances, so that you build the credibility of the mission. But the idea that through force you're going to stabilize a country is an illusion. Just like a police force in any country acts at the margin, because most citizens respect the law not because they are afraid of the police, but because they believe the law is right. They believe the law deserves being respected, and the police intervenes at the margin. In a conflict country, so long as you don't have that sense that there is a social compact, that there is some kind of understanding of what the political legitimacy is, you're not going through force to really, unless you have an overwhelming force that the UN will never have, you're not going to achieve that result. So what really is important is how the politics gradually convince more and more people that there is a legitimate state of affairs, and then the force can intervene at the margins and not be the centerpiece. And that's what peacekeeping should be about. My book is about intervention. It's about international engagement. And maybe that's the most difficult and the most topical issue today, because as we reflect on 15 years of engagement and the panel on peace operation, which produced what I think is a very good report, is a very thoughtful report. When we reflect on 15 years of engagement, of course we ask questions. And in 15 years of engagement, it's the UN engagement, it's the enormous growth of peacekeeping since 2000. When I arrived, there were a few tens of thousands of peacekeepers, and now there are more than 100,000. It's that enormous growth of peacekeeping, but it's also the operations led by the United States, the operations that were turned to NATO, it's Iraq, it's Afghanistan. And people ask, do we know what we are doing? Do we have the resource to do what we claim we want to do? Do we have the stamina to stay the course? And when you ask all those questions, you see that the pendulum of optimism that was really on the side of optimism 2000 has been swinging toward pessimism. It's just too costly, it's too complicated, we don't have really the stamina to address those issues, so let's hunker down, let's retreat. And my own thought is that we need, that this is the time to find a balance where away from the excessive optimism of 2000, but not retreating in some kind of sort of fortress, whether it's fortress Europe, it's fortress America, it will not work. It's morally wrong, and it's strategically unwise. but how you calibrate engagement so that maybe you have less ambitious agendas. When you think of the agendas of the 2000s, really about, in a way, re-engineering countries, retooling countries, that is something that is much too ambitious. We intervene in the lives of others. These are not our lives. If we make mistakes, we won't have to bear the consequences of our mistakes. And so there is a moral hazard there. So we need to be much, whoops, that's to say I'm gone much through my 20 minutes. We need to be much more humble, in my view, on what we set ourselves to do. But that itself raises very difficult moral questions. What peace is good enough? Who are we to decide what peace is good enough? It's one thing if you are a fighter in a movement to decide at some point that this is the time to lay down the arms. It's quite another thing for a third party to decide that now is the time to support peace. And so I think in those issues, we often must be more facilitators rather than imposing our own solutions. And in terms of what it means to stabilize a country, we must focus on a much more limited set of issues. I mean, I have a chapter on Haiti, a country dear to my heart, and a country that, in a way, is a particular challenge because Haiti is not the Democratic Republic of the Congo. It's a small country. So you would think that, in a way, if you put all the might and resource of the international community in to help a country like Haiti, you should be able to be successful. And of course, Haiti has been tragically unlucky with the earthquake that really, at the time when there was some progress being made, set everything back. But I think it's also the fact that as we look at Haiti, we see the complexities of helping another country that is not your country. What should we focus on? The security, the justice, the revenue, if the fundamental, the foundations of the state. If we pretend to do much more than that, then we appear as a kind of neocolonial power, and we are not in a colonial age. And so the difficulty that we have not found the solution yet is how do we continue to engage? How do we not give up? Because I think giving up is not an option. But at the same time, how do we realize that in our goals, in our ambitions, we probably must be much more modest than we were in 2000? And so the bell rung, so I should stop there.
I'm going to ask Jean-Marie a couple of questions, and then we'll go to the floor for your questions and thoughts. Jean-Marie, you mentioned protection of civilians, which is very much part of the mantra now of at the UN, of the mission of peacekeeping, and it's in peacekeeping mandates. The other word that comes up a lot these days is prevention. And you say in the book, prevention is still the best option, but, quote, despite all the nice talk about prevention, there is very little appetite in today's world for serious engagement in countries that have not yet reached the stage of full-blown crisis. If we agree that prevention is a good idea, is that bar to it? I mean, is that a reason why it cannot be adopted by the UN, or do you see a way where prevention can really be put into effect?
Well, I think countries, contrary to human beings, don't like checkups. They don't like to be told that they need the treatment because they're not doing well. And so the issue of sovereignty immediately pops up. I think one creation that has been developed in the last few years at the UN, which is a good one, is to have regional offices provided the person in charge of regional office is the right person. I think this is a way for the United Nations to go to a country without flagging too much that this country is in a state of crisis. It's probably more acceptable in a number of situations to have the head of the regional office, West Africa, in West Africa, etc., to engage without telling the country you are going to have mass atrocities, you're going to have a massive crisis on your hands, because then the leaders of the country will shut down and will be very hard to engage with that country. This is one little thing that provides an entry. But and I think also the Security Council, they should be more, they used to, I mean, the horizon scanning, which it should be done seriously. But with the present state of the Security Council, with the deep divisions within the Security Council, it's probably not the best moment to have that. And that's an understatement.
Another thing that's always at play at the UN is the tension between the rights of the people and the sovereignty of states. You acknowledge in the book that in 1993 you wrote a small book in which you predicted the end of the relevance of the nation state. I think in office you were to find that probably was a bad prediction. As a matter of fact, I remember when you came here in 2008, Terry Rhodes Larson, the president of IPI, gave a reception, a farewell reception for you, and standing here you were asked what was the one thing you had discovered that surprised you in your 8 years, and you answered some form of saying the importance of sovereignty to the nation states represented across the street. My question now is, have you worked out that tension between the rights of the people and the sovereignty of states as to how the UN ought to work?
If I had, my book would really be a bestseller. I would say, I mean, on this issue of the crisis of the state, yes, I discovered at the United Nations how sovereignty, yes, it can be the shield of dictators, and that is wrong, but it's also seen by a lot of weaker states and the people of those weaker states as a shield against the enormous imbalance of power between states. And that is something that, living in Europe, I did not really feel the same way I felt working at the United Nations. And so I can see that when states are fighting for their sovereignty, it is not just about dictators, it's also about the weakness of many countries, which feel, at least at one level, I'm the equal of the most powerful because I'm a sovereign state. And of course, in large part, it's a fiction, because how do you exercise sovereignty when you are very weak? Not very well. But that needs to be respected. And as I was working in peacekeeping, I thought that part of my duty and my challenge was to create a consensus about peacekeeping. And peacekeeping, as you know, they're the countries that pay the bill, the countries that make the decision, the countries that provide the troops, and they don't really, they're not the same groups. I mean, there are some overlaps, but not as much as one would like, for sure. And so that meant that I had a particular ear for those countries that claim their sovereignty. And I think one needs to really respect that. That it's a bit smug to think that now we are beyond that. I think we have to understand the position of weaker countries, that the only thing that they have to assert to protect themselves from the enormous imbalance of power is this concept of sovereignty. And that should be acknowledged. At the same time, now I go back to my book of 1993, I mean, now working at Crisis Group, I'm very much convinced that states are more and more under stress, and not just in Africa or in some crisis places. I think all around the world there is a crisis of the state, and that's a crisis for the United Nations, because the United Nations is an organization of states, and if the states are in crisis, in a way, the United Nations has a problem addressing a number of issues that it has to address. And that's how do you introduce new actors, non-state actors, whether they are rebel groups or whether they are corporations, when all the actors that today, and of course now at the head of the an NGO, I would say, how do you also give a room to space for NGOs? I have to plead for my own shop. But I would think that this is something that is a real major issue for the next Secretary General. How you give a voice in an organization of state to all the new actors that are more and more relevant to peace and security.
Last thing I want to ask you, you have a number of interesting case studies. I want to ask you about Darfur, partly because I was around at that point and followed it, but partly because you say in the book it pretty much ruined your last 2 years in office, or it was very frustrating those last 2 years. Any lessons drawn from the mistakes made in the creation of the peacekeeping force, which of course was a hybrid force with the African Union in Darfur? Looking back, can you think of things that you would now tell your successors, don't do that?
Well, I think the fundamental principle is that a peace operation, a deployment of troops in a country, it has to be willed by the country. That you cannot help a country against the will of its leaders, or if you decide to do so, that's an invasion. That's a different kind of thing, and there are other issues with that. I'm not promoting the concept of invasions. But I think the fundamental flaw in the Darfur intervention is that the government of Sudan, in a way, was never supporting it. I had the hope at some point that the Janjaweed had been unleashed on the population of Darfur, and that some in the Sudanese military felt that in a way they had a hard time controlling what they had unleashed, the Popular Defense Forces, etc., and that maybe some had an interest in sort of putting back in the box the Janjaweed. And in that sense, the UN or a UN mission could help. But I think the calculation of the President of Sudan was different. He thought that if there was a real effective mission in Darfur, that would open a political space, and that would be dangerous for his control of the situation in Sudan. So he was determined, I think, not to have an effective force. And then we went for the hybrid mission. I was not in favor of it, because I felt it diluted responsibilities. In a way, the member states could hide between two organizations instead of hiding just behind one. And that was not a good thing. In hindsight, maybe it would have been better just to hand over to the African Union and fund the African Union with UN assessed contributions. I was not keen on that solution, because I felt that the African Union did not have the military capacities, the command structures to do the job at the time. But it proved that the UN did not have it either. But cynically, from the UN, it would have been probably better to hand over to the African Union. But at the same time, it would have been a bit of a cynical calculation, passing the buck to an organization that did not have all the resources of the UN, did not have all the structures in place. So I don't think that in the end it would have made much of a difference. But certainly this hybrid mission deployed against the will of the Sudanese government, sort of forced upon it, could not succeed. Yeah, peace operation is a favor that is done to the country where it is deployed. If we have to beg a country to deploy, how can you succeed? You are putting yourself in a position of demandeur at the moment where you should be in demand. And that is a fundamentally wrong position to be in.
While we're on the subject of Darfur, before I go to the floor, you also say in the book that ICC referral is a bad idea. Can you explain that?
Well, I think the whole relationship between the International Criminal Court and the Security Council has not been well thought through, to be honest. Because I think both peace and justice suffer in that unhappy marriage. In the sense that, in the case of Darfur, I think the Security Council, Colin Powell having uttered the word genocide, so that's a pretty serious word. So there was a report, Cassese report, that rightly said, well, this is a legal issue. So it moved on, and then the Security Council, which didn't know what to do, surprisingly referred, that means, I mean, with no veto of China and Russia, surprisingly referred the situation in Darfur to the ICC, I think more to put pressure on Sudan than with a view to establishing justice. And I think that's where things go badly wrong. Because if you see justice as a pressure point, not justice for justice's sake, you are in trouble. Because justice cannot be turned on and off. It should not be. Justice is about justice. It's not a pressure point. And I think the way Darfur was referred to the ICC turned justice into a pressure point. And in reality, if you wanted to have some kind of political negotiation with the government of Sudan, which maybe was not possible, you can't rewrite history. But certainly, when it is about genocide, when it is about, you don't negotiate with the genocidaire in some way. And so there is a contradiction between peacekeeping, which is about compromise and negotiation, and justice, which is about much clearer distinction between right and wrong. I think both institutionally and conceptually, the link between the peacekeeping, the deployment of an operation, and the engagement of justice was not really thought through. And to this day, I don't think it is.
Thank you. Let's go to the floor for questions. I'm going to take three at once, if that's okay with you. So the gentleman there was the first one I saw, number two. And no, I was pointing to the man back there. Sorry, that man. Number two and number three, the man sitting in the Laurenti chair. And would you please stand up and, for the sake of the webcast, identify yourself?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, for giving me the floor. My name is Hussein Maliki. I'm the first counselor of the permanent mission of the Islamic Republic of Iran to the United Nations. And I'm very glad that Mr. Guéhenno is here. He is, in fact, the asset of the United Nations. And I can say that the peacekeeping is in his DNA. So now, I know there was a heavy rain. I just wanted to relinquish the idea of coming here. But when I remembered that Mr. Guéhenno is here, then I just came. You see my pants are wet by rain. Mr. Guéhenno, I have a comment regarding the risk-taking by the United Nations. We know that the United Nations, to be brave enough to take risk, so it needs tools. And one of the tools is the peacekeeping, which the forces provided by the member states. And really, if the United States wants to take risk, then it cannot, because it's not the tools, because it is the member states to allow their forces to go and fight, kill, and be killed sometimes if necessary. So it is very difficult for the United Nations to take risk in such cases. And then the another question is that, In the reports of these...
I didn't hear a question at first. Did you ask a question?
That was a comment.
Okay.
Comment. Okay, of course, Mr. Guéhenno can just...
Please ask the question. Yeah.
And the question is that, you know, it came in the report of the Secretary General last year, I mean, provided by the PKO, that despite decreasing the crisis in the world, but the UN, the personnel, I mean, the forces, has tremendously increased. Why is that so? If the crisis have been decreased, but the UN has been forces has been increased, and you know that the budget, when compare it to the 2000, for example, right now it's about $9 billion and more. So what is the cause of this? And then if I may just
want you to ask the question, because a lot of other people want to ask a question.
Yes, this is one question, okay?
Please.
And the second one, please, can I? Sorry.
Just ask the question and...
Yeah, so I think you have read the reports of the high-level independent panel on peace operations, which recently released. So just you as a really neutral and impartial one, that the member states and the United Nations cannot judge, I mean, impartially about that report. Have you read that report? And which part of the report just caught your eyes and drew your attention? And so just a little more about that.
Thank you very much. Thank Number you. Two over here.
You are here.
Thank you very much. Moses Onyango from Kenya, African Leadership Fellow, visiting with IPI. I enjoyed your presentation, and you seem to have anchored yourself on facilitation rather than imposition of values, to the extent that I thought I was listening to Woodrow Wilson. Now, my question is, how do you successfully facilitate change in an environment that is monolithic and also very complex? Thank you.
Excellent. And the third over there.
Thank you.
I think a mic is not on, Jeff.
Thank you.
Still not on.
Testing.
Jeff Laurenti. There we go. Jean-Marie, I want to explore a bit your suggestion that we should have more modest ambitions and take a locale or two as specific cases in point. You had been Kofi's deputy in the effort to try to stitch together some kind of peace settlement in Syria. Was that an excessive ambition? What did you see as the major impediments in that effort back in 2012 and following? What are the sources of leverage that might make a difference there or next door in the grandmother of all UN peace operations, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict? Should we be modest, or is there leverage that we haven't thought of yet?
Excellent. Okay, you want to answer those three and we'll get three more.
All easy questions. well, on the questions of Iranian colleague, first on, well, you're saying growth of peace operations and at the same time more conflict. So what is, why is that? I would say that at the moment there is not enough attention to long-standing missions, that there should be some reviews. We tend to add missions without really reflecting on what already exists. I also believe that in a number of situations, the missions freezes the situation but does not lead to a political solution. And the hard question then is, should one unfreeze the situation at the risk of sometimes considerable violence, or is the investment of keeping the situation more or less under control worth it? I think the argument of cost for peacekeeping is, to limit peacekeeping is not the best argument, because at the end of the day, $9 billion is a lot of money and very little money. It depends with which lenses you look at it. I think if the missions were deployed right, in a way, $9 billion is not such a huge amount of money when you compare all the money that is spent on military forces in around the world. But I do believe that at the moment the nature of conflict is changing, and so it's much harder to terminate conflicts than it used to be, because conflicts are not bound by political agendas, by national political agendas. There are much more transnational dimensions to conflict. So I think the challenge of peacekeepers, and not just peacekeepers, of peace operations in general, is much greater, because the environment of conflict is changing. And if you add to that divided Security Council, it makes things worse. Which brings me to the just issued report. I think it's a very important report. There's one central idea, there are a few key ideas which, in my view, are very important. One is indeed the idea of prevention, to take issues early on rather than to be in a reactive mode. But the other very operational idea is that the separation between peacekeeping, special political missions, the stovepiping of the UN doesn't make any sense anymore, precisely because of that complicated nature of conflicts, where it's all in the art of calibration. There are situations where you may need a lot of troops at the moment, and then less troops, and then again maybe more. There are situations where you don't need troops at all. It would be counterproductive to deploy troops. But you need to look at all the levers you have, the troops, the political, the development, and see how you orchestrate them in a way that will maximize the influence of the UN. And I think the UN presently is not very well organized to do that. And I think the idea, for instance, of having some kind of planning capacity that is independent of any particular department, that looks at those issues in a comprehensive way without thinking, oh, it's peacekeeping, it has to be peacekeepers, it's political, it has to be a political mission, but looks at a situation on its merits and not on its bureaucratic merits. That would be, if the UN could move in that direction, that would be a very serious progress, because, and precisely, it would address in a way your first question, that if we want to terminate missions, if we want to be able to move out of a situation, we need to be much more nimble and much less stovepiped in our bureaucratic categories. Now, the second question, how do you facilitate change in a monolithic environment? Well, you try to make it less monolithic. But your questions point to the limits of any outsider's engagement in any situation. At the end of the day, the future of a country is decided by the people of the country. And outsiders can only go so far. What is true is that I think we tend to underestimate in many situations how vibrant a society can be. I look at a country that is very close to my heart, the Democratic Republic of the Congo. I don't think that the political situation in the Democratic Republic of the Congo is satisfactory at all. I'm concerned at the elections when they come. I hope they will be open elections and that there will be renewal. But what the one sign of encouragement is I see how lively debate is in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. How many organizations, I'm talking about Congolese organizations, are discussing the future of their country. And that needs to be encouraged. That is fundamental for transformation. The future of Congo is not going to be decided by some deliberation of the Security Council in New York. It will be decided in the Democratic Republic of the Congo by the Congolese. But the Congolese, not just the government of Congo, a much broader segment of the population, and that needs to be reinforced and encouraged. Now, Jeff, question on having more modest ambitions, and I mean, you mentioned two examples. I mean, the question of Syria. I think in the question of Syria, it was not about modest ambition. I think in the case of Syria, especially at the time when I was working for Kofi Annan in 2012, you really have to address three levels. You have the level of the Syrians themselves, how they see the future of their country. And the situation was less difficult in 2012 than it is today, because the scene was much less fragmented than it is today. The extremist dimension had not taken the dimension that it has today. But I think at the time there was more engagement with the outside opposition than with the opposition within Syria, and probably that was a mistake. But that's one level. The second level is a regional one, and the third level is a global one. In 2012, there was a lot of focus. We focused a lot on the global level, trying to get some understanding, in particular between Russia and the United States on Syria. It didn't really work out, but I think the key is the regional level. And without that, and that's a broader issue for the region. And I hope that the nuclear deal that was just being completed will not lead to escalation of tensions in the region, but to the de-escalation. Because what is really needed is that between Iran on one side and Saudi Arabia, in particular, on the other side, there is a real need for a de-escalation and for an understanding. And easier said than done, but I think some discreet diplomacy is in order there. And the less visible, probably the better, because the sensitivities are such that if it is too much in the public eye, it will be very difficult to de-escalate the situation. But I think it will be very difficult to make progress in Syria in a context of deepening regional rivalries. And on Israel, Palestine, again, you're not going to resolve the question of Israel and Palestine from the outside. It will be the Israelis and the Palestinians who will do it. But at the same time, you can address some key parameters. I think that's something that is being broached for the Security Council. And you can address specific situations so that at least it doesn't get worse. And I'm thinking when we're working very actively on that issue at Crisis Group, and I'm certainly the question of Gaza on the one hand, the question of the Holy Esplanade on the other, are two flashpoints where if nothing is done, the likelihood that things will flare up again with catastrophic consequences for the people concerned is high. And so at a time when you don't see at the senior level the political engagement that makes the prospect of a resumption of the peace process very high, you have to work at least on those issues that will not make things worse. This is maybe lowering the ambitions, but it is important for peace in the region.
Let me take three more. My first is in the second row here, then this gentleman there, and then you there. Okay.
Thank you very much. My name is Yaya from the Africa Leadership Center, and I'm here at the IPI on fellowship. You have about 10 countries or 10 areas of peacekeeping in which you were involved. I'm worried about the future of peacekeeping, particularly with respect to what the UN can do. These 10 case studies, or more than that, that you have engaged with, I'm not sure terribly sure how, with due respect, the UN knowledge on this, on the conflict in those areas before UN intervention. Now you're sharing with us your experience in the memoir. So is it the regional organizations should be strengthened because they probably would have better understanding of the root causes of this conflict and better way of engaging peacekeeping operations with UN support, or how do you see it? Thank you.
Thank you. Who did I name number two? Yes, right there.
My name is Roy Licklider. I teach at Rutgers. Much of the discussion about peacekeeping and the problem centers on lack of resources and lack of political will, all of which are important. But at another level, there's a question of, do we know enough? Is there enough intellectual knowledge to actually do state formation with some confidence that you actually know what to do to get the results you want? And so my question is, based on your experience, what do we not know that we need to know?
And the third one is here.
Thank you. Fabien Dubé with Médecins Sans Frontières. I wanted to ask you about two expressions you used, actually, in the interviews around the book. The one was the need to return to politics, and the other one, the need to maybe remember the sense and the value of dialogue. And so my first question is really about, within the context of peacekeeping, whether you think there's sometimes a contradiction between the protection of civilians' mandate and the mediation efforts, sometimes because it creates illusions or it distracts you and others to address the root causes. And then beyond the peacekeeping context, whether you think that we've lost a bit what are the fundamentals of diplomacy, which is precisely to value dialogue and the sense of dialogue. Thank you.
Okay.
Well, I think the three questions in a way are connected. The question of, do we know what to do when we deploy? And does the UN know? There's actually a very good recommendation of the panel on peace operations report to recommending that UN resolutions be accepted, be adopted in two stages. Because it's true that at the UN, we make critical decisions at the very moment that when we know the least. And that is wrong. We shape a mission when we don't really know the environment in which that mission is going to be deployed. And so taking the time to assess the situation, to fine-tune what really needs to be done, would in itself be a great progress. And there's another part of your question, which is really about regional organization versus the UN in terms of knowledge. And that's a tricky one, because regional organization, yes, when you are closer to the situation, you know more in principle about the situation. You also have more direct interest. And sometimes you see the regional engagement with the risking, in a way, the regionalization of the issue in the wrong sense. The regionalization also of regional rivalries entering the conflict. And so sometimes being at a distance has its advantages. And I have sometimes spoken to African friends who are saying they were not unhappy to have some kind of distant third party. So I think behind your question is really the relationship between the United Nations and the regional organization. And that that relationship, to be honest, hasn't been worked out yet. Because at the global level, there is sometimes a kind of, let's be honest, a bit of a cynical view. Let's give it to the African Union. We don't have to deal with it. At a time when everybody is looking at ways to save money, it can be an easy, popular way of pretending that you are empowering regional organizations, but at the same time, you just don't want to get involved. And the regional organization, they have their own power relations within the regional organization, and you see it in Look at a place like South Sudan. I mean, it's fraught with regional rivalries. Look at the situation in Somalia. Look at the situation in the Democratic Republic of the Congo and the Great Lakes. So it is not so simple that you just pass to the regional organization and you have the solution. What do we know? What do we not know that we should know? Well, I think, in a way, what I just said is what we really should know. That is, if we do not have a good understanding of the political dynamics of the situation in which we are getting engaged, we are unlikely to make headway. And the biggest weakness of any UN deployment, or any deployment for that matter, whether it's the UN or the US in Iraq or any deployment, is the fact that there is not a serious understanding of the dynamics of the country. And when it comes to the collapse of a dictator, there is that illusion that behind the dictators there is a happy family waiting to blossom. And that is not the case. Actually, the more absolute the dictatorship has been, the more dysfunctional the family, so to speak, underneath. And so the greater the problem, which is not to say you have to keep the dictator, which is to say that you have to be prepared for a very complicated situation. Look at Saddam Hussein. And that is just understanding. And that is hard. And that is what the UN actually, I think, it needs to reach out to various sources of knowledge. That's where integration between those who deal with politics, those who deal with peacekeeping, makes eminent sense. That's where reaching out to regional organizations when they have some knowledge, to put all the good minds that have some understanding of a country together to try to assess the complexities of a situation, I think that's vital. Now, return to politics and dialogue. In a way, I mean, that's where the three questions are connected. It is indeed all about politics. No society can survive, can prosper, if it does not have some kind of political understanding, which is not necessarily a democratic understanding, but which is some accepted set of institutions and relationship between the various components of the society. And that is both formal and informal institutions, state actors and non-state actors. And there, and that comes to your question on dialogue, I am struck by how the space for dialogue is shrinking. And there the very, I think, broad use of the word terrorism and terrorist is not a good thing. Not that I condone in any way the horrific acts of terrorism committed around the world. But terrorism is a tactic. It's not a political movement. And many organizations at some point in their history have committed terrorist acts of terrorism. And I think for the United Nations, one essential is to be able to talk to anybody who is prepared to talk to the United Nations. And that means, sadly, that a number of interlocutors will not be reachable because they, at the moment, they would not accept to talk to the United Nations. They would kill whoever wants to talk to them. But this has to be, in my view, the posture. And I think Western governments, in that respect, have not had the right policy. Because if you have a policy that you talk to anybody who is willing to talk, then talking does not become legitimization. If you begin to decide who is beyond the pale, who is acceptable, then, of course, talking becomes a political signal. But the paradox is actually that Western countries through their intelligence organization, they do talk actually to a range of organizations, but they don't admit it. And they make a policy that the UN shouldn't. That is wrong, in my view. The UN has to have the political space to engage any actor who is prepared to talk to the UN. That's politics. That is essential if we want to move forward in a number of conflicts.
We only have about five more minutes, so I will get three more questions. Please, very concise questions in the second row, in the back, and this woman here.
Thank you so much for your presentation. I'm Stephanie Minou, a fellow at the African Leadership Center and currently visiting IPI. My question is directed at two questions that you raised in your presentation, which are really, I think they were just fantastic. You said, what peace is good enough? And who are we to decide what peace is good enough? That's what you said. And I would like to reflect on this notion of peace, you know, because you also provided a definition. I embrace Johan Galtung's definition of peace, whereby we're not just looking at the mere absence of violence, but we're also looking at addressing the structural factors, you know, that would lead to violence as well. And when in your presentation, I have the impression that the UN is only focusing on eradicating violence, as in like military violence, if I can put it that way. And if many of these peacekeeping operations are actually taking place in Africa, whereby the root causes of conflict are actually rooted in issues like poverty, hunger, and all of that, to what extent does the UN actually place emphasis on other elements such as these structural factors? And probably, if you believe that it is the responsibility of states, which I think, you know, states also play an important role of this, what kind of conditions does the UN create to let these processes actually take place? Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie. In the back.
Matthew Lee, Inner City Press.
Hold it up, Matthew.
Sure. I had more wind up to the question, but as you said, I'll try to just keep it straight.
Please do, because we're almost out of time.
You said that you kind of either recused yourself or didn't take the lead on Cote d'Ivoire when you were the head of DPKO. The current Undersecretary General doesn't similarly recuse himself on Mali, CAR. I wondered what you think of France controlling DPKO four times in a row. Is it time for a change? Of country, not of USG, and on CAR, just if you can, with the allegations of rapes by the Sangaris force, what do you think the UN can or should do in terms of investigating it, getting to the bottom of it? Thanks a lot.
And then finally, who did I name number three? I picked somebody. There you are. Thank you. Very concise, please.
Thank you. Yes. Urania Yankopoulos, I'm an intern with the Mission of Cyprus. Our ambassador just left.
I know.
And also a student at Columbia University. And I was wondering if you might address frozen conflicts and peacekeeping missions in frozen conflicts such as Cyprus. And maybe the question, when do we critically question and look at the role and impact of these peacekeeping missions? Are they really there to decrease some risk of violence, or are they maybe more acting as a crutch to any real peace settlement process by the two communities or however many communities involved in that frozen conflict?
Thank you. Let's see if you can do all that in about 3 or 4 minutes.
Okay. Well, the first question is the most difficult one. I mean, how does the UN address the dimensions of peace that go beyond ending the violence? I think, again, I go back to the politics, because when you say poverty, when you talk about the root causes, at one level, I agree with you, but I think more and more people who look at development see that if you do not address the politics of development, it doesn't work. And so I think the UN ought to focus on helping institutions consolidate themselves. That will allow conflicts to be managed through institution rather than with a gun. And that is the key political challenge. Have we helped build institutions that are robust enough to do that? My great frustration, for instance, with the Democratic Republic of the Congo, is I don't think that is the case at the moment. And that should have been the focus. Then, my view, that is a much more important thing, in a way, than the military dimension. But the complication is that you gain your credibility by making a military difference that you make or don't make. But in reality, that credibility, you have to use it for politics. But there's a curve in the life of a mission. When you arrive, there's a lot of expectations, and you can do much more. Then your credibility is a wasting asset. And it's much harder years later to have influence than if you try to use it early on. And I think, essentially, since 2006, to take the concrete example of the Democratic Republic of the Congo, since the election, the first election, the leverage of the United Nations in Congo has been extremely limited. The question on is it time for change, DPKO? I think it's always good to have change, and I would expect that there will be change. I think no position should be the property of a particular country, even my own. And on the Central African Republic, when I've only read the press report, I have no insider information. I felt very sorry because I have enormous respect for Prince Zaid. He has done a stellar job in the report he did for Kofi Annan on sexual abuse. And a lot of the recommendations that he put there have not been implemented. And although he pushed hard, and we all pushed hard, and I think if they had been implemented, we would not be where we are on the Central African Republic. And I think if one just went back to the basics, went back to what was in the Zaid report, I think that would be the best answer to this horrible situation in Dakar. On frozen conflicts, when I was at the UN, and I mentioned that in my book, I looked at what I could do with frozen conflicts. And sadly, I came to the conclusion that on many situations, I couldn't do much, to be honest. That, in a way, the political capital and energy I would spend was not worth the savings. Because the big mission, the mission that really drive the cost of peacekeeping, they are not Cyprus or Western Sahara, to take two frozen conflicts. They are the Democratic Republic of the Congo. They are Sudan. They are South Sudan. They are the big missions with lots of peacekeepers. I think in Cyprus at the moment, for the first time, there is hope of a resolution. I think it points to, the leadership on all sides, and I think then the mission could withdraw. I think in Western Sahara, there is a frozen conflict. There is a situation where, in my view, the fact that the underlying situation has never been resolved, in spite of the Baker efforts, which was, I think, the strongest effort that was made to try to resolve that issue. I think that is not good for the people involved. I believe that the mission, in a way, help freeze a conflict, and that's a good thing because it's a low-cost freeze, so to speak. And that if you tomorrow pull the mission, you would have more problems in the area than with the mission. And so I'm not sure that there is a strong rationale to pull out the mission. But I think the political effort should be there. And again, it's another situation where you can't have peacekeeping on one side and political efforts on the other. The two need to be connected, and Western Sahara is an illustration of it.
I'm going to keep Jean-Marie here to sign books. If you purchase them, they're for sale out in the hallway. But before that, please join me in thanking him for what's a very wise